Good morning and a very warm welcome to the third meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. This morning we have received apologies from Mr. Ruskell. Our first agenda item is the committee will take evidence and hear from the government on the previous evidence heard during the committee's inquiry on the UK internal market, and we welcome to committee this morning, Angus Robertson, Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture in the Scottish Government, from Donald Cameron, Deputy Director, Constitution and UK Relations, Scottish Government, and Ewan Page, Head of UK Frameworks, Scottish Government. And I welcome you all to the meeting, and Cabinet Secretary, can I invite you to make an opening statement?
This morning, I think it's my fifth session with the committee of this Parliament since we last met. I've also given evidence on Common Frameworks and the Internal Market Act to the House of Lords, Common Frameworks Scrutiny Committee, and I've been in regular discussions with my counterparts in the UK government and with other devolved governments as well. Any inquiry into the internal market regime imposed by the UK Internal Market Act must be seen in the wider context of the devolution settlement, which in 1997 people in Scotland voted overwhelmingly to re-establish a Scottish Parliament. And with our own Parliament, we've seen things like free personal care, university tuition fees have been abolished, no one's now charged for prescriptions. These initiatives and many more have improved people's lives in Scotland immeasurably. But now what we're confronted with is an effort by the UK government to put the gains of devolution at risk by taking control once again of key devolved powers, and doing that without consent, without the permission of you, the elected members of the Scottish Parliament and indeed the Scottish government. Devolution has in some quarters always been seen as a problem to be fixed in some parts of UK politics, where the UK is mistakenly conceived of as being a unitary state rather than a voluntary political union of nations. And this view has become increasingly obvious since the EU referendum and can be seen most clearly of all in the issue that we are deliberating over today, the Internal Market Act. And the Scottish Government's opposition to the Act is clear. It is well known and understood. We have argued from the outset that it represents a fundamental change to the devolution settlement that people voted for in 1997. It's a change that was achieved by stealth. It was a chipping away at the powers and responsibilities of the Scottish Parliament. And the majority of the Scottish Parliament agrees with that and has voted overwhelmingly to refuse consent to the Act, as did colleagues in Cardiff, while in Northern Ireland the Assembly passed a motion rejecting the bill. No devolved legislature has consented to the Act, and yet, despite this overwhelming rejection, the Sewell Convention was once again ignored, and the Act has been imposed on us. These concerns were and continue to be dismissed by UK ministers as scaremongering, and instead we've been told that somehow this Act represents a power surge, if that were to be believed, following EU exit. Convener, it's just over a year since the Act has passed into law, and we now have a growing body of evidence that vindicates our position, vindicates the concern of the overwhelming majority of members of the Scottish Parliament. And witnesses to this inquiry have laid bare the negative impact of the Act. If I may, because I've had a look at the evidence that you've been able to garner so far, there are certain contributions that really stand out. One, which goes as follows, and this is a direct quotation: the Internal Market Act could create risks for the integrity of the existing devolution settlement, and in particular for the integrity of the regulatory prerogatives that the Scottish authorities enjoy in accordance with the Scotland Act 2016 in the area of public health and especially alcohol control policy. That's a view of Professor Nicola McEwan of the University of Edinburgh. In a further quote, the Internal Market Act views devolution and the potential for divergence as an obstacle and a potential irritant to the economic integration of the UK which is prioritised and privileged through the market access principles of the Act. The Act undermines devolution and will limit the ability to the Scottish Parliament and Government to improve farmed animal welfare standards. That contribution from one kind, Kirsty Jenkins, in a written submission to the committee. I could go on. You have had a lot of evidence which has underlined the concerns which we have, but it's not just in the Scottish Parliament and not just in the devolved institutions that these concerns have been amplified. Only a few weeks ago, Lord Hope spoke on BBC Scotland, marking the publication of a House of Lords report. And he said as follows, the problem has been while it was always understood from the beginning that Westminster would not make laws for Scotland which cut across the devolution system without the consent of the devolved administrations, they did not respect that, particularly with Brexit. And that created a great deal of mistrust and indeed hostility. And in responding to a question about whether the Internal Market Act strengthens or undermines devolution, Lord Hope said, well, I think the Scottish Government are right about that. Lord Hope is a crossbencher in the House of Lords, a very independent and well-versed member of the House of Lords who agrees with the position of the Scottish Government on this, agrees with the majority view in the Scottish Parliament on it. And while Lord Hope and I may not see eye to eye on the best constitutional future for the UK, it's difficult to argue with the clearly expressed views that he gave only last week. Convener, the reality is that the Act means that devolved powers will now be exercised in a system designed and controlled by UK ministers. Much was heard from UK ministers during the passage of the bill about how the proposals simply replicate the rules that provide for regulatory coherence in the EU single market. This is not the case. UK Internal Market Act does not provide any of the exemptions and protections for local autonomy that are enjoyed by members of the EU single market, nor do its provisions mirror the internal market rules that pertain in other devolved or federal states. Delegated powers in the Act enable areas currently controlled by devolved parliaments to be brought within the scope of the market access principles by UK ministers. And these powers mean that UK ministers can change the scope of the Act unilaterally. Indeed, the UK government is expected to seek the consent of devolved governments to changes to the services exclusions regime as we speak. The fact of consent may sound reassuring. However, any such assurance would be false. Although there is a duty in the Act requiring UK ministers to seek the consent of devolved governments before such changes are made, the UK government can proceed after just 1 month, regardless of whether that consent has been given. In conclusion, Convener, the Act has also made other significant changes that are worth noting. It allows for the first time UK ministers to decide how money in Scotland should be spent on wholly devolved policy areas, spanning culture, sport, education, economic development and infrastructure. Money that should be for the Scottish Parliament, for you, the members of the Parliament and the Government, to make your own choices about in line with the priorities of the people who have elected you, elected us. Or, as the First Minister of Wales pithily observed, the Act steals money and powers from Wales. Again, it's difficult to disagree with his assessment. Convener, the Act represents a fundamental erosion of the devolution settlement and the departure from the principles and practices of devolution experienced over two decades. No doubt we'll come on to questions about what can be done to mitigate or to work with the grain of the Act now that it is unfortunately a reality, but my response will be plain. The Act cannot be reformed or properly mitigated. It is an internal market regime which has been imposed on its constituent members without their consent. It is inherently unstable, it is unsustainable, and the only way to address the Act's harms is for it to be repealed.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. We'll now move to questions, and perhaps I could open questions with a question about a submission from the Law Society, which refers to a SPICE briefing on common frameworks, which addresses the question of what new governance arrangements will be needed to make common frameworks work. The paper states that when more decisions are taken through intergovernmental forums, accountability and parliamentary scrutiny can suffer. Consequently, this increases, and I quote again, the importance of ensuring that intergovernmental bodies are transparent and accountable. So I'm going to ask what your view is on this, Cabinet Secretary, and how do we ensure that common frameworks process is transparent and accountable to the Scottish Parliament and its committees?
It's likely that you're going to touch on a range of issues in relation to frameworks, because it impacts in significant ways and should do in relation to the Internal Market Act. Just to update the committee in terms of where we are at the present time, because it is we're in a moving and evolving situation. We are now moving forward to formal scrutiny of frameworks in all four legislatures across the UK, and officials have been sharing cleared provisional frameworks with parliamentary officials prior to publication. We have seen some initial scrutiny of frameworks that was in the spring of last year, and some frameworks have come forward for scrutiny in recent weeks. I know that, for example, my colleague, the Health Secretary, was giving evidence on frameworks in his policy area last week. There are a number of factors that have impacted on the development of common frameworks, not least of these being the impact of the pandemic, and officials have been called away to other tasks. Biggest single impact, however, has been on the UK government's decision to introduce the Internal Market Act, which raised fundamental questions over the purpose and viability of the common frameworks. And it's taken considerable time to work through the Act's impact and to develop mitigations. Now, in terms of stakeholders in the frameworks process, and that obviously includes the committee, as it involves everybody else who has a locus in this, there was a multi-phase process, frameworks for its development, and there was extensive stakeholder engagement. And it's encouraging to see the level of stakeholder interest in common frameworks from early witnesses to the inquiry. And the clear consensus of frameworks offer a much better model for cooperation on managing policy divergence than the Internal Market Act. The views of stakeholders on the efficacy of the frameworks will be central, will be important to us as government. No doubt it will be important for you as committee in terms of taking evidence on how things work. And then, of course, you have your ongoing scrutiny. And as I said at my opening statement, I think it's the fourth or fifth time I've been with you. I'm happy to come back. And I'm happy to update you, as are my officials, and I think my colleagues were introduced at the beginning, who do a lot of the technical work on this. And we are happy to keep you apprised of how things are working or are not working, because we're at the stage of seeing whether the UK government, in effect, is going to recognise the workings of the framework, which, in effect, should allow for the divergence of policy across the UK. Either they're going to allow that to work, or they're not. And there are examples that I can go into. I don't want to prejudge any questions that you might have, but there are some very current issues where we'll be able to see where the UK government is minded on allowing us to get on with what we've actually been elected to get on with.
Thank you very much. I'm going to move to questions from committee members, and I'll invite Ms. Minto first, to be followed by our deputy convener, Donald Cameron.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for joining us again. I'd like to touch on a couple of things that you just raised in your introduction there. In yesterday's contribution to the Scottish Parliament Committee's debate on the scrutiny of Scotland's budget, the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy noted the importance of being able to tailor our response to Scotland's needs and Scotland's priorities. You mentioned in your introduction about the less generous local regulatory autonomy that the UK Market Bill gives us, Internal Market Bill gives us, compared to the EU Internal Market Bill. And as you noted, the UK government has started spending in devolved areas with no recourse to the Scottish Parliament. You touched on education. I was thinking specifically of the Adult Numeracy Fund, despite education being fully devolved. And I wonder if you could expand a bit more on your thoughts, the Scottish Government's thoughts on this change.
Well, this is one of the most problematic areas of this whole issue. UK ministers are now in a position to decide how public money, so money that you, I, our constituents have paid in taxation, should be spent in Scotland. And the UK ministers have not been elected for that purpose, but they are now going to make decisions on the basis of their priorities that they were not elected to do in Scotland. So at the heart, there's a democratic deficit and a democratic problem with all of this. I mentioned in my opening remarks, this cuts across a whole range of devolved subjects, culture, sport, education, economic development and infrastructure. And it bypasses you. It bypasses your colleagues. And that is profoundly wrong. UK ministers haven't wasted any time in using their new powers in areas where you should be in charge and not them. And the spending is uncoordinated. It's not coordinated properly with the Scottish Government, and it's not subject to your appropriate scrutiny. So, for example, over £152 million of funding from the Community Renewal Fund, plus the initial rounds of the Levelling Up and Community Ownership Funds, have now been awarded to projects in Scotland. Now, I mean, it almost goes without saying, funding for worthwhile projects is a welcome thing. Who would gainsay that? That is not what is at issue. It is about how we manage resources and priorities and what are the democratic mechanisms for doing so. And so to give you two very concrete examples, firstly, the Multiply programme. And this is an area which involves a £560 million, this is not small, numeracy programme. And Multiply, this fund, will be top-sliced from the UK Shared Prosperity Fund and delivered by the UK Department of Work and Pensions across the whole of the UK. Now, that is despite devolution being wholly involved. No engagement took place with the Scottish Government prior to the announcement, and it means that there's likely to be duplication, waste, with the Scottish Government's adult learning strategy, which is to be published in the spring. That's one example. Second example relates to the Shared Prosperity Fund. Now, the UK Government has shared some thinking around the role of the Scottish Government in the governance and operations of the Shared Prosperity Fund as subordinate partners, not equals, not co-decision. And I say again, this is devolved areas, so it is the Parliament, it's the Scottish Government that should be responsible. Nevertheless, they're proceeding. Three options have been proposed in Whitehall. None of them has yet cleared with government ministers, and each of them has an ever decreasing role for Scottish Government. All of the options state that the UK government ministers will have the final say, and a ministerial board has been described with the role of ministers from devolved governments in an advisory capacity only. Scottish Government has seen the initial paper on the indicative priorities of the UK Shared Prosperity Funds, and it raises significant questions about the strategic nature of potential projects, and it only highlights our concerns regarding distant decision making, unelected for these issues, making these decisions. And that's not just the view of the Scottish Government or indeed the majority of members of the Scottish Parliament. Recently, the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, the umbrella organisation for the country's voluntary organisations, highlighted the view of their members that funding priorities should be set at a devolved level, tackling inequalities, enhancing human rights, promoting well-being, and they say by linking outcomes with Scotland's national performance framework and other relevant policy frameworks. So the SCVO has raised concerns over the management of the Shared Prosperity Fund being managed centrally by the UK government, and it just echoes the concerns that the government and indeed members of the Scottish Parliament have had since the beginning of this process. So things are beginning to happen, and what we are seeing is indeed what was foretold would happen.
Thank you for that. It leads me on to quoting something that Professor Nicola McLean talked about as well, about the fact that UKIMA could have a longer term chilling effect on legal and policy reform. And this was reflected as well in evidence that we received from Alcohol Focus Scotland. Specifically, they talked about whether there would still be the ability to bring in legislation like minimum unit pricing of alcohol, given that health was one of the areas that countries within Europe could choose the appropriate legislation to support the needs of their country. So I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on that area and the chilling effect that UKIMA could have.
Well, no doubt it could theoretically have a chilling effect. I suppose the good news for you and colleagues who think it's important for the Scottish Parliament to deliver what the people have voted for is that the government is not going to entertain a chilling effect, even if it feels chilly at times. We're going to try and deliver what we've been elected to do. And you know, let me give you some practical examples, because sometimes I think this issue can sound a little bit theoretical. Yeah. And people say, well, what's that got to do with me? And you've already mentioned one in terms of minimum unit pricing. I can come on to that. I can give you a very, very current example of an issue which is subject to the difficulties of the situation that we're talking about this morning. And that relates to single-use plastics. Now, we're all trying, I think, our best to do better by the environment, so that we can live in a more sustainable way, so our economy operates in a way which is less damaging, and by our actions that we are more considerate for the next generation who will inherit things. And some of these things may seem small, but they will make a difference, and they're part of a wider changing approach to sustainability issues. And the specific issue for us where this kicks in relates to single-use plastics. And we all know, because we've all used them in different circumstances, polystyrene drinks cups, polystyrene food containers, single-use plastic stirrers, plastic cutlery, straws, balloon sticks, plastic plates, all of these things which are used and then are just discarded and causing environmental degradation. Now, that is not sustainable. And so that's why we have been pursuing new rules to end their use. Now, you know, and I should say that legislation was laid in the Scottish Parliament to do this. So it's been decided, supposed to be happening. However, we may not be able to enforce the ban in Scotland, as the UK Internal Market Act effectively exempts any items that are produced or imported via another part of the UK. So we can make a democratic decision saying, we're elected to do these things, we need to change the way we live and be more environmentally sustainable, but the legislation that we're discussing now drives a coach and horses through our ability to do so. And just because other UK nations are moving more slowly than Scotland to ban these products, I mean, I very much hope that they follow Scotland's lead in this. I mean, what's good for us is going to be good for people in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. But it's their democratic right in our neighbouring nations to work at their own speed. What's not right is them telling us that we can't legislate in areas that we have competence for and using the Act to stop that. Now, we are working with the UK government to use the Common Frameworks procedure to make sure that we can deliver what we have been seeking to deliver. But it's a very concrete example of that. And there are others. Another one on the horizon relates to horticultural peat and the banning of the sale of peat for gardening products, and this is because of the impact degrading this part of our environment is not something that we want to continue with. However, if one was to continue with the provisions of the Internal Market Act, it could effectively mean that the controls in Scotland can be overridden, and that is unsustainable. We can move on. There are issues around food standards. There's the risk of to health measures such as minimum unit pricing on alcohol and so on. And there are others that will be coming down the track. You asked about the chilling effect. We refuse to be artificially chilled, if I can put it that way. But the risk exists. And if there were a less a committed government in Scotland to protecting our ability to make our decisions, you could easily imagine that people would be sitting in private rooms going, "Ooh, we better not proceed with that thing in our manifesto because of the Internal Market Act." You know, that is not a, has no way to govern a country. You know, the minute any of that comes along, I would very much want to be working with you and the committee to shine light on this so that you can understand the impact that it's having. Of course, we have to test everything we do against the risk of not having cover through the frameworks, which would mean that things would be open to legal challenge. And that is, you know, it's a big problem. Now, there is a solution to that, of course, which is, well, in the first instance, one could get rid of the Act. My preferred option would be that we, Scotland is a sovereign country that makes sovereign decisions about its own market, and I would prefer for us to be in the biggest single market in Europe, and that would move us into a much better place with a system that we knew and was tried and tested when the UK was still part of the European Union.
Thank you for that. Thank you, convener. I've got other questions, but I'll stop there. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Minto. I'm a little bit conscious of time, so if we could have succinct questions and answers, Cabinet Secretary, go forward, that would be very helpful. So invite our Deputy Convener to be followed by Alistair Allen. Thanks. Donald, I think that's you.
Unmute.
But we're not hearing. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and his officials. I'm just picking up on that last point. I think much of the evidence that the committee has heard has been of the sort of hypothetical nature of what might happen in the future, and that many potential challenges have been identified, but we're still very much in the realms of what could happen. So I was keen to ask you about existing Scottish government policy commitments which are being impacted, and interested in your example of single-use plastics. Could I just ask, have you had any communication from the UK government that the market access principles are definitely going to cut across that policy commitment?
Heads up to my officials on the call that I'm about to pass the ball to them on the latest technical stage of where things have got to. I think I shared with the committee in a previous evidence session that I'd been involved in a very productive and very positive range of discussions with Chloe Smith, who was a then Cabinet Office Minister, to try and get the frameworks process out of the mud where it had managed to get stuck. The reason for that being that, you know, unless we made progress on understanding what the frameworks were actually there to do, they were going to fail. We worked quite hard on that and in good faith, and managed to get things to a place where, through assurances that were given by the UK government, mirroring ones that they had previously given in the dispatch box in the House of Lords, that we could proceed with the frameworks, which, as you know, allow us in certain circumstances to protect the position of devolved decision making. Having said that, only with the say-so of UK government ministers, and we are in the process of that procedure at the present time, and that's why it's going to be helpful, I think, for my colleagues on the call to explain where we have got to, what we know is working as it should have, and how it may work, and we hope it does, but why it may not. And I suppose at the heart of this, what I would leave you with the thought about is we may be really fortunate in some instances and find that we have a sympathetic minister, I don't know, in DEFRA, for example, or in another UK ministry, who goes, okay, we see why the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament are wanting to do this. I'm the minister with responsibility in the UK government. I'm going to be gracious enough to allow the people who are elected to do these things to get on and do them. But equally, we may find that there are others who are less empathetic, sympathetic, or understanding. And I think that at the heart of this should concern all of us as Democrats and elected parliamentarians, is that we have offloaded, well, we haven't voluntarily, it's been done to us. The power has been taken from you. Somebody else is sitting in judgment, and that is currently where it is, on the Secretary of State's desk. So I'll hand over to Donald Cameron and Ewan Page, if they can jump in and give you the latest on where we are with that.
Thanks very much, Cap Sec. So to answer the Deputy Convener's question and to follow on from Cap Sec's remarks, I think it's important to go back to the way in which the bill was first of all introduced and the very truncated time available for consultation and for scrutiny. I think colleagues will remember or will recall the very truncated period. I think some of the issues that we would normally have expected to have emerged as a result of that process are emerging now. So there is an extent to which we are in a process of discovery about the impact of the market access principles in particular, but perhaps make a couple of further comments about what we're doing within the Scottish Government. First of all, we're kind of tracking impacts across the range of the Scottish Government's responsibilities. So as we develop policy, as we think about legislation, then we are making an assessment about the likely impact of the Act. And the CAPSEC mentioned a number of examples where we have our assessment is that there will be an impact. But two further points. First of all, there is agreement with the UK government that, in the example that the CAPSEC gave around single-use plastics, that the market access principles would definitely bite on the Scottish Government legislation. And for that reason, there is a discussion through the Resources and Waste Common Framework of the need for an exclusion to be granted by the relevant UK Secretary of State. So no doubt that the market access principles would bite on the single-use plastics legislation. And then more broadly, a recognition that for all policy issues covered by a common framework, the market access principles are thought likely to bite. So that is quite a broad-based set of impacts.
Thank you. I don't know if Mr. Page wants to comment as well, but
no, that's
okay. So thank you for those answers. I suppose it's a question of what's happening in as a reality. I mean, we all have views on the Act and the wider internal market, but I suppose it's whether even if market access principles are impacting on devolved policy decisions, how that plays out in practice and whether they can be resolved. Which brings me on to my second question, Cabinet Secretary, which is around intergovernmental relations. Now, about 10 days ago, the three-tier approach was published. And I wondered, given that the Scottish Government signed up to that, do you see that as a viable method of working through any challenges or disputes even that might arise either under common frameworks or under the UK Internal Market Act?
Well, we go into this very much with good intentions and hoping to make things work. Of course, it is set to replace existing arrangements which are theoretically supposed to bring people together and theoretically allow them to work through difficulties. And I suppose if I were going to highlight the concern that I have, is that you can tinker with formal ways of working, but if at the heart of it one isn't actually interested in making that work, doesn't matter what setup is in place. And my example is I think is quite a good one, where because I had a UK government interlocutor who I think was really interested in trying to make something work. We made it work because it was self-evidently in the interest of the UK government and the Scottish government's interest to make progress. This is the frameworks. This is the process I was describing before, Mr. Cameron, with Chloe Smith. And that delivered results. Unfortunately, as we know from previous arrangements, it didn't take that very long from the establishment of the previous system that prime ministers didn't really turn up to the top level meetings, that UK government secretaries of state would devolve responsibilities to their junior ministers to turn up in their stead. They weren't in a position to make decisions on the department's responsibility. That rested with the Secretary of State, who was too important or too unavailable to take part in things. And I'm just highlighting that, you know, we have long experience, unfortunately, of the UK government not thinking that this is I can't come up with any other reason to explain why they wouldn't turn up, or why they wouldn't be sending along the right people, or there have been other meetings that colleagues have been turned up to and been told that they don't have speaking rights, and you know, all of that is has been indicative of, unfortunately, of intergovernmental relations in the UK in recent months and years, and it's not good, and it could be a lot better. And if people want to operate on the basis of faith, then it should do, and we will make the best of the new arrangements that have been put into place, and hopefully that will mean that the needs, interests, concerns, and expectations of the devolved administrations and legislatures are actually listened to and respected. But I would just highlight again, there is a world of difference between saying that we have been consulted with, and that, in contrast, we have worked through issues from inception to decision on a collegial basis. These are two very different things. And I hope that decision makers in Whitehall have said, yeah, we need to do things better. Here's a new way of doing it. Let's take a run at it, a good run at it. I hope they do, because I think in many respects, we will find that there's no reason to find things difficult and to make progress, so long as there's a respect, of course, for the devolution settlement.
Can I ask finally, in terms of intergovernmental relations, it strikes me that although there are political differences at the top and political relationships, some of which work, some of which don't, that on an official level, we're in the process of agreeing common frameworks that sort of down level, if I could put it like that, relations are quite good and effective, and that actually that if you look at, you know, both the past and the new system, there is grounds for optimism that the sort of more technical nature of a lot of this can be resolved. Would you agree with that?
I hope so. And yes, it's true that officials I've been involved all the way through on being updated on, you know, what's the latest meeting been like on a technical level? Where have we got to? And what one often hears is people have not had political sign off to go beyond certain stages. And so even if there is a goodwill at a technical level, often one hasn't been able to proceed. That's observation one. Observation two, there are certain UK government departments that have an inherently better understanding of the devolved nature of governance in the UK than others. And so it's also important to differentiate that there's not a single approach by the UK Civil Service in Whitehall and the Civil Service in Scotland on this. Let me concentrate on the positive, because I'm a glass half full kind of person. We have a new structure. Let's try and make it work. Let's see how the concrete examples are proceeded with. Let's give things fair wind. This is not an issue that is being exaggerated by anybody, as you will know from the evidence you received across the board. This is not a concern just of government or of the majority in the Scottish Parliament or of the voluntary sector or of representative bodies. These concerns are reflected across the piece. So we are dealing with something that is quite serious, but I do want to rest on my glass half full approach, which is I really want to try and make some of this stuff work. And I have the benefit, if you want to call it that, having been in Westminster for quite a long time, that many of the interlocutors that I might have are people that I know. And that also counts for something in trying to act in good faith and moving things forward. But at some point, one is going to have sign off for proposals for legislation that the government and the parliament has enacted, and UK government ministers are either going to allow what has been democratically decided to go ahead or block it.
Well, on that positive note, I will hand back to the convener. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to invite Dr. Allen to be followed by Mr. Golden. Thanks.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You're certainly a regular customer of the committee, and we look forward to UK ministers hopefully being similarly cooperative in future. My question was really about how the UK Internal Market Act relates to other measures, and you've touched on this in your introduction, but I'm interested in what the cumulative effect is on policy, particularly as it relates to devolved administrations, all three devolved administrations. You mentioned unhappiness in that quarter. I know that there's been coverage about unhappiness on the part of the Welsh Government about the impact all this have in terms of policy in areas like education. So I just wonder if you could say a wee bit about what contact or what you've heard from other devolved administrations about what they feel is the cumulative effect of the UK Internal Market Act plus other measures.
That we are at an early stage of these, of the law, the Act biting, and at an early stage of the application of frameworks in certain areas. So it's there are some known knowns, and you're right, I think Welsh colleagues have had much to say on proposals in relation to spending in certain parts of Wales. I think there's a feeling that decisions have been made to spend money in certain parts of the country where people have a preponderance to vote for the Conservative Party, so politically motivated spending, which, you know, that's no way to govern. And incidentally, you know, in a week where we've been hearing that there have been threats from within the UK government to members of parliament that spending projects wouldn't go ahead if they didn't vote for the government in one way or another. I mean, another example, this is not how one should govern anywhere, and that should give us all cause for concern. I think at the moment, the extent to which there is a guiding hand for UK government spending in devolved areas is not yet obvious. Money has begun to be spent. They have begun to spend in areas where they have next to no experience about devolved policy delivery in Scotland. So the example I gave on education is an insight to that. The fact in some other areas there is on the margins, a recognition that there should be some sort of Scottish Government advisory input, but not co-decision. I think there's a bit of me that thinks that they know they have a presentational problem, but this sort of spreading largesse approach to how decisions are made and how things are spent. I mean, it's just no way to do things. But the cumulative effect of that is something that we're only going to be seeing as more projects are funded, as more spending areas are identified, and the extent to which there is coordination. Now, we in the devolved administrations do speak with one another, and one thing I would highlight to you, you don't need me to point this out in any great detail, you'll know this already, is while I'm speaking to you as the Cabinet Secretary with responsibility for constitution and the sort of global sense of how we understand the application of constitutional instruments, this is going to impact directly on individual portfolios in government in Scotland. And so, as I mentioned before, this is something that was talked about in one evidence session by one of my Cabinet Secretary colleagues, and that is equally true for all of the other policy areas as well. So it's not just about the theoretical global level. I know you were asking, is there a cumulative effect that we can point to at the moment? Well, the cumulative approach so far is that, you know, it doesn't involve the Scottish Government, and they just go ahead and do what they think they want to do without any recourse to the people who are democratically elected to do it, i.e. you. I would be delighted to see an evidence session with a UK government minister sitting where I am, answering questions from you and your colleagues to hear how they explain the lack of democratic oversight. I look forward to tuning in to that evidence session.
Well, on the back of that, I mean, we have, of course, a situation where, as far as I understand it, the UK government are presenting funds like Shared Prosperity are levelling up essentially as a new money. You've mentioned the impact it's going to have on individual portfolios. Can you say a bit more about the impact that it's going to have on if you like, Barnett consequentials and, for instance, the decision to essentially expand an English Shared Prosperity Fund across the UK? What's the implications of that for the block grant?
Yeah, well, I mean, I would definitely be pointing in the direction of the Cabinet Secretary for Finance and the Economy, Kate Forbes, who'd be able to give you a much better granular understanding of how that is then reflected in the budgetary process in Scotland. I mean, we have had a problem for a while now of having a lack of clarity about consequentials. And that has been the case in my area, for example, in culture. We have been asking for a long time now about, you know, £40 million worth of UK government consequential funds for culture, which haven't, you know, been fully received. And one has very opaque answers, and one is then told there, you know, there may be clarification in a later stage in the budgetary process. Now, that's not great in spending departments. Now, Constitution, External Affairs and Culture is by no means one of the biggest spending departments in the Scottish Government. There are others for whom this is really very, very problematic. And then over the whole, I know that this is an issue for Kate Forbes as a Cabinet Secretary with the responsibility for budgetary issues. It's very difficult to understand whether there are going to be consequentials for certain kinds of funding and not for others. And there's a suspicion, which I think, you know, people are right to have, which is that this is a mechanism to avoid consequential spending. Again, which drives a coach and horses through the devolution settlement. And we should all be concerned about. And it's not good governance, quite apart from anything else. I mean, we can talk about the democratic legitimacy of the process, which is thin gruel. But in terms of good governance, if we're not coordinating, and by we in the royal sense, I'm talking about the UK government is not working in to the normal custom and practice, which it's expected to, and to the standards that it should be held to, then it doesn't make governance any easier. And that is not good, because at the end of the day, we are all here to do a job, which is to deliver for the people. And if our processes, intra-government processes on a financial and all the other levels that we've been talking about, is not operating properly, well, that has to have an impact on service delivery and you know, how the country is run, and that is not a good thing.
Finally, you've hinted, Cabinet Secretary, at some of the UK government's motivations behind all this. In a state that operates without a written constitution, but operates on precedent and expediency, where, in your view, is this all going? Are we moving into a period where the UK government is looking upon the Sewell Convention and the convention that the powers of the Scottish Parliament aren't offered without the Scottish Parliament's consent? Are we moving into a period where the UK government is looking upon the Sewell Convention as constitutional history?
Well, let's just start on the views, on the basis of the views of the Prime Minister, who thinks that devolution is, and to quote, a disaster. And everything that we've heard in relation to his views on the subject gives you the insight that he is not a supporter, he's not a fan, he would much prefer decisions to be made by him and his government, and, you know, putting, I'm paraphrasing, putting devolved administrations in a box to be managed, and managed more effectively. And I think there is real reason to believe that there is, because they have overwritten things like the Sewell Convention, and, you know, are happy to ignore devolved administrations in any host of ways, having got away with it, I think we're right to be concerned that, you know, that is continuing and is going to be amplified. I see absolutely no sign, notwithstanding new arrangements that the deputy convener Donald Cameron was raising, if that is the great white hope for better governance in the UK, then I'm yet to be convinced. Let me say that.
Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Just to remind members that the Finance Committee is leading on scrutiny of the Shared Prosperity Fund, and I wouldn't want to be stepping on their toes in questioning going forward. So can I bring in Mr. Golden, please?
Convener, Cabinet Secretary, the Scottish Government's stated position is to align with EU law. How do you monitor that Cabinet Secretaries and Ministers are adhering to this? For example, the delay to the deposit return scheme could see divergence from the EU circular economy package.
Well, Mr. Golden, nice to see you, and nice to see you with your clock on the wall. I was joking with you earlier about whether this was an attempt for me to speak longer or shorter. I'm not sure which it is, but anyway, nice to see you with your clock in situ. I think this is an area where, when I gave evidence in a previous evidence session, I think it was the third that I was at, where I was discussing, this is a very sort of evolving and new area of governance, and finding our ways of managing the issue. I think at that committee session, I said that I was very keen for us to work out a sustainable way going forward, to be able to share with you different issues that are proceeding through the pipeline of policy that government has to deal with, so that you can satisfy yourself, because of your scrutiny requirements, about how things are being dealt with. And I think that that's something that my colleagues have been in touch with parliamentary officials to try and find a route forward. I think on specific issues at the moment, giving the example that you've got, I think that's where ministerial colleagues who are dealing with their individual subject areas are best placed to say, here's how we have considered it, here are the options that we had, here's why we've alighted on this way of doing it, and whether it's in mirroring the content of European legislation or the spirit, here is how we have decided is the best way to go forward. And it's almost like on different legislation, both in Westminster and Scotland, where one sort of highlights if there are any issues that relate to human rights or previously when we were members of the European Union, how that relates to standing European Union policy. I think that is going to be the best way for you and colleagues who have an interest in this to follow it, rather than me who is not, and I'm following the convener's pointer just a moment ago in terms of the financial oversight of things, is where subject ministers are dealing with specific subject issues or legislative processes that they are the best people to give the updates in a sort of evidential sense. But secondary to that, and not directly connected, is the as yet still to be finally progressed method that we can, between the Constitution Directorate and yourselves as a committee, have a system in place that satisfies your scrutiny concerns. I don't know if you and Paige, who's one of my big brain colleagues, who's been working in these areas, wants to jump in.
Looking to Mr. Cameron.
Hi. Thank you. You go first.
Okay, Mr. Page. Sorry.
Apologies. Sorry. Yes, to come back on Mr. Golden's original point, Scottish Government policy is to align with EU law where it is in Scotland's interest. So it's a discretionary power, and as the Cabinet Secretary has indicated, it will be to look at policy decisions in the round before coming to a conclusion on what is the best route. On the deposit return scheme, officials working on that policy have determined that the Act does pose a threat to the ability to legislate in this area. But as Donald Cameron has indicated earlier, because we're in a position of post hoc, post implementation analysis of the policy consequences of the Act, which is a consequence of lack of adequate pre-legislative scrutiny, we need time to work through the full policy implications.
Thank you, Mr. Page.
Mr. Cameron, do you wish to get in?
Oh, thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Golden?
I'm conscious the clock on the wall is ticking away, convener. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you, officials. I'll move back to you, convener.
Okay. I'm going to move finally to Ms. Boyack, and could ask members of the committee, if they do have any more questions, to put an R in the chat, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener. I would like to ask a couple of questions of the Cabinet Secretary this morning. I think the answers have been very interesting to colleagues' questions. And in the light of the experiences with the UK Internal Market Act, I was wondering if the Cabinet Secretary could outline his priorities for intergovernmental work. There's clearly an issue across portfolios here, and you've talked about the transparency that we've asked about in previous discussions that we've had with yourself on the common frameworks. So if you had a short term, not to fix everything, but what would be the priorities in terms of expecting a different approach, both in terms of the UK government ministers, but also in terms of civil service relations on those issues, so that the problems that you've identified are actually able to be aired and acted upon?
A very, very good question, Ms. Boyack. So, I mean, I think the formal position is there are structures now that should enable discussion to take place, and that must lead to adequate conclusions. As I've shared with you, I think that's not enough, because we're dealing with human relations and we're dealing with different human priorities. And in politics, you're talking about different administrations which take different views of things. And I think there is a fundamental cultural problem in Whitehall government departments. And by this, I mean the political top down in terms of relations with devolved administrations. Now, you asked very specifically about me. What is it that I can do in relation to this?
Yeah.
And the truth is, I'm quite limited in terms of what I can do. I know that if I am involved because of my particular area of responsibility, which is going to be quite technical. So that was the reason that why I was having these interchanges with Chloe Smith, dealing with, the, you know, in the Cabinet Office, which deals with Constitution, dealing with me as a Constitution Secretary for the Scottish Government, as opposed to colleagues, I don't know, you know, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs or for Education, who might have to jump on a call to discuss something. And then, you know, may, amongst other things, have the feeling this feels very much like a decision's already been taken, and I'm taking part in a meeting which, because one is in it and one is able to feel what are the interchanges like, do they sound substantive or do they sound pro forma, that one is simply going through the motions to satisfy a sort of a tick box agenda of, well, we've consulted with Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland, which is a world away from saying we need to join up our thinking at an early stage, identify if there are any impacts with the devolved administrations. If there are things that need to be taken on board, take them on board seriously. And I mean, I think in some respects, it depends on who you're dealing with. I think there's some people you can deal with very well, and you know, don't want to embarrass them by saying that they have been very collegial in working with us. I mean, it kind of goes without saying that civil service will they will work to the brief that they've been given and to the general direction that they get from their Secretary of State. In terms of what I can do beyond that, I think because there is a sort of coordinating role, and I should say intergovernmental relations falls within the orbit of the Deputy First Minister, is making sure that we have consistency from all Scottish Government ministers and civil servants at meetings. And I think because we spend so much time, don't we, on Teams calls and Zoom calls, things can kind of just they seem a sort of oneness of being in endless meetings about things. But if we're trying to make this new system work, I think we almost need to signpost the fact that this is a new system and we have to make it work. And then it's over to other people. And, you know, I have no doubt because we have excellent relationships. I mean, this is the thing that grieves me somewhat with it, because, you know, for grown-ups, we should be able to work beyond, you know, fundamental political differences, say, in the constitutional future of the UK and Scotland. When talking about technical and policy areas, I mean, I managed to do that with Welsh Labour colleagues. I managed to do it with colleagues from Northern Ireland, regardless of what political side of the fence they're on the constitution. But I'm mystified why it is often so challenging when dealing with UK government interlocutors, but then that's because they feel that they're in charge and it is for us to do what they say. And that is not the case when it is in areas of devolved responsibility. And that's the area of difficulty that we find ourselves in here. So the short answer to your question, Ms. Boyack, is what I can do is limited. One thing in addition that I can do is make sure that we across government in Scotland have an institutional memory across the departments and along all of the interactions so that we know we can quantify the nature of the interrelationship. And that is something that I look forward to reviewing, because I'm regularly saying to colleagues, when I hear examples of meetings that colleagues can't speak at, meetings where one just says noted, meetings where there one is arriving to have substantive discussions about things and there are none, I'm making sure that we have an institutional memory of that so that people know that this isn't just some sort of let's blame big bag Whitehall and because we're pro-Scottish independence, we're bound to say that, aren't we, sort of analysis. It's not where it is at all. I mean, on just on a practical level, it has not been working well. We have a new system in place. Hopefully it will work well, but we require institutional memory and to remind colleagues in Whitehall that things need to be a lot better.
Institutional memory, cross-departmental working. So you've already just said that John Swinney is Deputy First Minister. He's in charge of intergovernmental relations. Kate Forbes is in charge of telling us if there are implications for UK consequentials. So it does actually suggest that there is a need for that cross-Scottish government working, as well as that UK government working.
That's why if I gave the impression that there wasn't, that's not the case. So I, we do
have. Is that available to us so that we could see that analysis? Because I think one of the things we would be keen to see is how it does kick across different governmental areas, because I was going to ask you about support for Scottish producers in terms of the Northern Ireland Protocol and the impact of UK internal market. But having listened to your previous answer, I'm guessing you're going to say that that's a different minister will respond. So in terms of the institutional structures, are there recommendations in the House of Lords committee report that came out last week on the constitution that would be useful for our committee to look at? Because there's an issue about structure, there's an issue about individual ministers, which has always been an issue, and then there's an issue about the processes, so that you as a minister or your colleagues have those structures, as we've talked about before, in terms of common frameworks, so that this can be monitored and we can get the parliamentary accountability for those issues as well.
Yeah. Well, there's quite a lot in that in those questions, Ms. Boyack. I mean, first on the House of Lords report, notwithstanding their conclusion on the constitutional arrangements going forward, I think there's a lot in it, and you know, it's not for me to say which bits you should or shouldn't be looking at. As is often the case with House of Lords committees, they're often very detailed, and there are some very intelligent people involved in the. In the process. I think they're always worth going through, even things that you might not agree with. On the coordination point, as I would hope you would expect, we do talk to one another across government. We do, in general terms, about intergovernmental relations, but we also do specifically in different policy areas, so that you know, there have been deep dive discussions around intergovernmental workings as they impact on different departments, and that's where I was making the point that, you know, this is not, quote, simply for the Constitution Secretary or not simply for the Deputy First Minister to take a view on or have an oversight on. It is really important that everybody across government is seized and across Parliament is seized of learning the lessons in terms of. Having some insight to analysis. I mean, I don't have a report in front of me that sort of lists up numbers of meetings and, you know, has some sort of traffic light system gauging the mood music at meetings. It's not in that sort of format. But I am keen that we are retaining a form of institutional memory, so that when for example, government ministers go to next meetings, it is on the basis of remembering what happened at the previous meetings, if things had not worked well, if things had not proceeded with. And so to that extent, one isn't just turning up at yet another meeting without seeing as part of a sort of continuing institutional interrelationship. You know, I'm very clear that we're going into these meetings and we're trying to find solutions to things, and we're trying to work respectfully with colleagues from other parts of the UK. And go back to my glass half full, we're right at the start of a new way of working. I hear briefings that the Prime Minister might deign to turn up to meet with First Ministers from Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. We'll be interested to see whether it's Secretaries of State who turn up for meetings with cabinet secretaries, who are their opposite number, or whether they choose to send junior ministers in their stead. I think notes will be kept of that. I think it will be very clear to see how, on a formal level, the relationship is being taken seriously at Whitehall or not. And then you will hold us to account on the substance of what happens at these meetings and evidence sessions like this.
Thank you. I think that actually is quite important, though, in terms of accountability. We've talked about that in terms of the red traffic light system for common frameworks. And I think what would be useful to us would be that cross-governmental feedback, because there are issues. You've had questions from colleagues about the monitoring of the Internal Market Act and its impact on devolved issues in relation to agriculture, environmental standards in recent months. You've got the impact on Barnett consequentials. So there is something about actually this being properly processed. So I think that would be something this committee would be interested in, because we do have a cross-government overview ourselves in the way that you do. And I think we are very keen to monitor that. And I was just smiling when you used your thin gruel comment about the UK consequentials. That is a brilliant analogy of how our local government colleagues sometimes feel in terms of the Scottish government. So there is something about intergovernmental awareness that is actually at all levels of government. So be very keen to get some feedback on that as a cross-government analysis. I think that would be useful to our committee's work. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks.
Thank you. I'm not seeing any other questions from committee members. Cabinet Secretary, can I just finally ask, as a parliamentary committee, our role is to scrutinise the policies and decision makings of the Scottish Government in our operation. But are we moving to a situation where executive decision making, both at the Scottish Government level, but particularly the UK Parliament level, means that that scrutiny and opportunity to scrutinise policy decisions could be lost going forward?
I hope not. As a parliamentarian, as much as a government minister, I mean, I have repeatedly said to this committee, I'm happy to come back as often as you want me to come back, and I think I qualify for a frequent flyer pass now. I'm having passed five visits, and happy to come back. I would hope that UK government ministers would be happy to give evidence, as I have to House of Lords committees in great detail at great length. Because I think scrutiny and shining a light on all of these things is essential to making sure that they work well. It keeps people like me on my toes, keeps civil servants knowing that questions are likely to be asked. All of these are good things, and we shouldn't be scared of them. We might not always have the answers, but if we don't have them, we probably should get them. My position is, the strong committee system of the House of the Scottish Parliament was set up specifically to make governance in Scotland work in a better and different way, and I'm committed to making that work. I move forward in that collegial sense, and the suggestions that you make along the way and the questions that you ask along the way, really have an impact with me and those who have advised me, and that is exactly the way it should happen.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm not seeing any other questions. We will be seeing you again next week, I'm afraid. So it'll be, a sixth time in front of us. But thank you once again for you and your officials, Mr. Cameron, Mr. Page, for the attendance this morning. Before I close, I did speak on behalf of the committee in the committee budget debate yesterday in the Parliament, and in delivering my speech I omitted to thank the members of the committee and my deputy convener Donald Cameron and indeed our clerks for their support over the budget scrutiny process. So I do so now, and that's on the record, and on that note I'll close this meeting of the Parliament.
Thank you, and thanks for having me.